Karl Menger, the founder of Austrian economics, made a number of important contributions. One of those was his theory of the origin of money. It's not only an exemplary spontaneous order story of an institution that arose from human action but not human design. It's also widely accepted among economists as the explanation of how money emerged and evolved. For Austrians, Menger's theory has a dual importance. As an explanation of money's origin, it has important implications for money's role as a social institution and the emergence and operation of banking and finance systems. As a spontaneous order story, it sets out a method for explaining and analyzing the emergence and functions of social institutions that have wide applications. Menger's theory begins by assuming people are engaging in barter exchange. The problem with barter, of course, is finding someone who wants what you have and has what you want. This is the problem of the double coincidence of wants. If I'm interested in obtaining eggs and I grow corn, I have to find someone who not only has eggs they want to sell, but who wants to take corn in exchange. This is going to be very difficult. There might be a lot of egg sellers, but they may not be interested in having corn in exchange. This absence of the double coincidence of wants makes it very difficult to exchange and makes it very difficult for economies to grow and prosper. What Menger argued is that people's frustration with this process will lead them to seek for new solutions. One of those solutions they will develop is to imagine other goods that they might hold stocks of that would be more easy to exchange with other people than whatever it is they grow for themselves. So in my example, I might think to myself, well, people don't seem to want to buy corn, but they might be more interested in trading for something else. If I can trade my corn for that other thing, I can use that other thing to trade for eggs and whatever else it is I might want. This idea of indirect exchange, that is taking two steps to exchange to acquire something you might not really want in order to trade it for something you really do, becomes an important step in money's evolution. What Menger argued was that people will try out different goods in this role as an exchange intermediary. Over time, some of these will work better, some of these won't. What Menger also argued is that people have watched each other and are aware of the success of their friends and neighbors. As they see some people finding exchanges more easily to engage in because they've made good choices about those intermediaries, Menger said those people will get imitated, and more people will begin to use a smaller number of goods as intermediaries in this way. Eventually, Menger argued, this process will converge down to one or maybe two goods that serve as widely accepted media of exchange. This, he argued, is money. What we mean by money is a generally accepted medium of exchange. When everybody, or almost everybody, is using the same good to effect these exchanges, we have money. Menger's story also helps us to understand why the precious metals served as money. Gold and silver were considered to be very valuable, very popular, they're pretty to look at, they make nice jewelry, they had certain strengths and uses that people thought were valuable. They were also sufficiently scarce, easy to divide up, and had all kinds of physical properties that made them useful as money. There's nothing inherent in gold and silver that makes them useful this way. It's that people valued them as metals. What's interesting about Menger's theory is that what works as money can be culturally specific. It's the goods that people value that might work effectively as money. What Menger's theory does is to give us a spontaneous order explanation of money's emergence. Notice that no one in this process intended to invent money. Everyone was simply exchanging to improve their own position, and as an unintended consequence of their self-interested behavior, they produced a socially useful good that we call money. There was no Sir John Money who invented money in 1917. It emerged out of this exchange process. Money is a product of human action, but not human design. In 1912, Ludwig von Mises raised a series of questions about the value of money that enable us to extend Menger's story into a new area. This is what's often termed Mises' regression theorem. The quandary Mises posed was the following. If the value of money today depends upon prices today, that is, how much the money you're holding is worth depends upon what it can buy, and those prices today depended upon the value of money yesterday and the buying and selling decisions that people made then, and the value of money yesterday depended upon yesterday's prices, which depended upon the value of money the day before, you can see the problem. We're stuck in what looks like an infinite regress. How did money ever get any value in the first place? Mises' answer to this problem was to point out that the first value of a money as money is linked to the value that money had as a commodity. gold's first value as a money is tied to the value gold had as a commodity before it became a money, when it was a consumption good. In other words, money emerges out of exchange, just as Menger said. So the money value of a commodity must link up with the exchange value of the good that became money before it became money. One implication of this is that all money in use at any time can, in theory, trace its value back to the value of some good as a commodity. Therefore, you cannot introduce a new money without linking it to some existing money that can be traced back to the value of some commodity. This point has important implications today for Austrians as they debate cryptocurrencies and Bitcoin and try to figure out whether or not things like Bitcoin violate the regression theorem. Money is a spontaneous order. No one invented it. It's a product of social evolution. It's a human convention that emerged as the product of human action, of human choices, but not human design. We explain its emergence by showing how those choices add up to something that's greater than the mere sum of the parts. This is how Austrians proceed to explain a whole variety of social institutions, from private property to the family. That economic and social institutions are created by processes that we did not design and cannot control should make us very reluctant to try to direct them from the top down or reconstruct them according to some human design. The ways in which we've tried to do that with money and created all kinds of problems in doing so should serve as an excellent cautionary tale about why respecting institutions that emerge through spontaneous ordering processes is so important.